Dragonfire melts stone.
Dragonfire.
The realm. Do you know what the realm is? It's the thousand blades of Aegon's enemies. A story we agree to tell each other over and over till we forget that it's a lie.
What's up, ladies and gentlemen? Welcome back for another A Song of Ice and Fire video. In this video, I want to mostly talk about what happened on the night Aegon the Conqueror brought fire and blood to the enormous castle known as Harrenhal. As you all know, the upcoming HBO series House of the Dragon will be based on George R.R. Martin's book Fire and Blood. In my last video, I said I wanted to start making videos on the chapters from Fire and Blood because there is a good chance we could learn more about this information in the new series House of the Dragon. As I was reading the first chapter in Fire and Blood, I decided I would make this video based on some of the information given in that first chapter, which covers Aegon's conquest. This is one of the many scenes I would love to see brought to life on the television screen. Now, even if you haven't read any of the books, I am sure most of you will remember Harrenhal from Game of Thrones. All of you should remember the location because this is where Jaime revealed what happened during the night he executed the Mad King. This is where Brienne fought the bear, and this is also where Arya shared many scenes with Tywin Lannister and Jaqen H'ghar. I think this is one of the most fascinating castles in all of the Seven Kingdoms. However, if you have only seen Game of Thrones, then you might not know that much about why this castle now looks like a graveyard. The show did give us a basic description about what happened here, but in this video, I want to go over some of the more interesting details about the castle and that historical event.
Greatest fortress ever built. Tallest towers, the strongest walls. The Great Hall had 35 hearths. 35, can you imagine?
The man who is responsible for commanding the construction of the largest castle in Westeros, which set right on the northern shore of the God's Eye, was known as Harren Hor, also known as Harren the Black. He was the last of the kings of the Isles and the Rivers to rule over the Iron Islands and the Riverlands. One thing I want to do is give you a sense of just how massive Harrenhal was, because it's just absolutely insane. It's said that Harrenhal is the biggest castle in Westeros, but what exactly does that mean? Well, it's also said that Harrenhal's chambers were built on a scale that would be more suitable for giants than your average man. Harrenhal actually has the largest chamber in Westeros, larger than the Iron Throne Room and the Red Keep. The castle has these five massive towers that makes it look as if the castle has fingers reaching for the sky. Harrenhal actually covers three times the amount of land Winterfell does, and where Winterfell only has 3 acres for its godswood, Harrenhal has 20 acres of land for its godswood. Now, one of the details that really struck a nerve with me is how Harren the Black ordered men to cut down 3,000-year-old weirwood so he can use them as rafters and beams in his castle. This castle actually has kitchens that are roughly the same size as Winterfell's Great Hall, and it also has stables that can house 1,000 horses. Many also believe that this castle could garrison 1,000,000 men. Basically, everything about this castle is off the charts. By the time Harrenhal was finished, Harren the Black was an old man who now had gray hair, because the construction of this castle lasted for nearly 40 years. Now, although Harren's house had full control over these lands for 3 generations, the men of this region had no love for their ironborn leaders. Harren the Black had sent thousands of men to an early grave during the construction of his great castle Harrenhal. You see, King Harren had enslaved the Riverlands to raise the mightiest fortress Westeros had ever seen. Now, in order to build something that big, there has to be a lot, and I mean a lot of resources. This is one of the many reasons why he started to lose support by the time Aegon's conquest began. When you consider the amount of lives that were lost, and the amount of resources in that area that were used up during the construction of Harrenhal, you can start to see why the Riverlands he once ruled over were now beginning to rise up against him. Now, what's really interesting is, on the same exact day the new castle was finally finished, Aegon Targaryen landed at the mouth of the Blackwater Rush to start his conquest of Westeros. Harren the Black and his newly built castle was about to face their greatest test. So, as Aegon and his sisters were gearing up for an attack on Harrenhal, Harren the Black summoned Lord Edmund Tully of Riverrun. But as I said before, since the Riverlands were beginning to rise up against Harren the Black, instead of defending Harrenhal, Lord Edmund Tully declared for House Targaryen instead. He raised a dragon banner over his castle, then rode forth with his knights and archers to join Aegon the Dragon. That was a big moment for everyone else in the Riverlands because that gave them another reason to abandon Harren the Black and join forces with Aegon Targaryen. That's exactly what happened. The Blackwoods, the Malisters, the Vances, the Freys, the Brackens, and many others descended on Harrenhal rather than defend it. As soon as King Harren the Black realized he was outnumbered, he took refuge in what he thought was the greatest fortress in all the lands. Harren the Black laughed as he locked his gates and settled down with his remaining sons and supporters to withstand a siege. He was confident that Aegon and his men were no match for the castle. He did have an unlimited supply of water, massive vaults stocked with food, and giant walls of stone that were higher than any ladder, and too thick to be broken by any battering ram or shattered by any trebuchet. He was ready for this day, or so he thought. You see, Harrenhal may have been able to withstand an assault from all the armies in Westeros combined, but this great fortress was no match for Dragonfire. Right after Harren locked himself in a castle, Aegon sent his maester to the gates under a peace banner so they could negotiate. Harren the Black went out to meet him, looking all old and gray, yet still fierce in his black armor. Both of the kings had their maester in attendance, so the words that they exchanged are still remembered. "Yield now," Aegon began, "and you may remain as Lord of the Iron Islands. Yield now, and your sons will live to rule after you. I have 8,000 men outside your walls." "What is outside my walls is no concern to me," said Harren the Black. "My walls are strong and thick." Aegon responded by saying, "But not so high to keep out dragons. Dragons fly." "I built them in stone," said Harren the Black. "Stone does not burn." Aegon ends the conversation by saying, "When the sun sets, your line shall end." It is said that Harren sped at that and then walked back to his castle. As soon as he was inside, he sent all of his men outside to defend the castle. He offered lands and gold to any man who could bring down the dragon. He also said, "If I had a daughter, you could have her as well." Now that Edmund Tully had joined forces with Aegon, Harren the Black then said, "Instead, I will give the man who brings down the dragon one of the Tully's daughters, or all three of them if he likes. It makes no difference to me." Harren the Black was ready for war. Right as the sun was about to set, Harren the Black's men stared out into the darkness, holding onto their weapons, knowing what was about to happen next. After another few moments had went by, they thought that maybe Aegon had left. Maybe his threats were hollow. But Aegon Targaryen had something else in mind. On the back of his dragon, Balerion the Black Dread, he went up into the sky as high as he could, up and up and up, until the dragon looked as if it were no bigger than a fly sitting upon the moon. Only then did he descend, well inside the castle walls. Balerion the Dread was blacker than the night sky, moving through the air like a missile as he dove through the clouds. When he had the castle in his sights, the dragon erupted like a volcano as his fire rained down upon them. "Stone walls do not burn," Harren the Black said, but his castle was not made of stone alone. Wood and hemp and straw and bread, salted beef and grain were all set ablaze. Harren the Black's Iron Men were not made of stone either. Smoking, screaming, and shrouded in flames, they ran across the yard and fell from the walls to die upon the ground below. Even the stone began to crack and melt when the fire became hot enough. The river lords outside the castle walls said later that the five great towers of Harrenhal glowed red against the night, like five great candles melting up in the sky. Harren the Black and his remaining sons died in the fire that engulfed his enormous castle that night. His entire house died with him. On the very next day, as they were standing outside the smoking ruins of Harrenhal, King Aegon Targaryen accepted fealty from Edmund Tully, Lord of Riverrun, and named him the Lord Paramount of the Trident. When the ashes had cooled enough to allow the men to enter the castle safely, the swords of the fallen, many shattered or melted steel by dragonfire, were gathered up and sent back to the Aegon Fort in wagons, later to become some of the swords that would make up the Iron Throne.
The realm. Do you know what the realm is? It's the thousand blades of Aegon's enemies. A story we agree to tell each other over and over till we forget that it's...